Okay, so now we move on with the conference. First of all, before starting, I must remind you about our sponsorship. Thanks to their material support, we are here today. And these are Daniel Biotech, Teva, Neotech Bio, De Groot, Eldan, Levant, Pronto, Thermo Scientific, Medicine, Focus, Bargal, IAT, ATI, and Renew. Thank you very much. And with this, I do want to move on and start the first session and new perspective and advances in the clinics. And I would like to present to you the plenary speaker and the invited speaker of today. His name is Professor Arnold Munnich, and So he's from the Inserm, a highly renowned scientist, has hundreds of publications, and most importantly, he has identified about 20 disease-causing genes. He's an eminence in the investigation and clinical promotion of rare diseases. And please, Professor, come here.
Where is my picture? תודה רבה להזמנה, תודה מיגל. אני כל כך שמח להיות פה היום ולפגש את החברים, המנטורים שלי, יואב קבנצ'י, קורלי, אל פלג. אז, really, it's a tachless conference. Exactly, it's a privilege for me because we in Paris were exactly where you are. So I am the head of a department of genetic at Necker Enfants-Malades Hospital. 30,000 patients a year, 30,000 rare disease patients a year. This is the largest pediatric genetic clinic in Europe. And of course, you know that each child is different. We are not facing a small number of frequent conditions. We are facing a huge number of unique cases. All those child are unique, with different genes or different mutation in genes. It's so important to tackle the problem as the meeting has decided to tackle it today. I start with two slides just to summarize my objectives. I would like to point, not to blame, but to point the ignorance of what is presently available and working, the fascination for futuristic prospects like gene therapy or stem cell therapy, and a trend, at least in Western Europe, to preconceived ideas and a priorities among scientists and an oversimplification of information presented by the media. So my goal today is, to, first of all, outline what is already possible and to render under César what's César's. My main point today, and this could summarize my whole lecture, is causality is what it is all about. Understanding the disease gene and the disease mechanism is the best way toward tackling the condition. Gene identification indeed puts us on the right track, but replacement of a gene is one option among others and not the panacea. What is striking to me as an old pediatrician is that we have slowly commuted fatal condition into chronic condition. And the challenge, the alternative, is no longer to either die or recover, but rather to protract lifespan and life with a chronic condition. This is our challenge. I would like to remember that the story has not started today, nor last year, but a number of outstanding scientists have contributed to the first treatment for genetic disease, or rare genetic disease. I have no time to go through all those items. You know them: dietary management, organ transplantation, protein and drug engineering, enzyme therapy, gene therapy. But I would like to emphasize the impact of pharmacology, exactly the scope of the meeting today. Dietary management. Aurélie Peleg is a specialist for inborn error of metabolism. She knows better than I that a number of conditions can be treated with a low protein diet, with dietary management, and this owes very little to gene identification, but to the proper understanding of the disease mechanism. And this is not only from the past. Each year, we find new metabolic diseases that can be tackled and cured by dietary management once we have understood the proper disease mechanism. And probably one of the most stimulating chapter in this new era is the discovery of vitamin or cofactor responding conditions in metabolic disease. And again, this is not like a chapter of a textbook, but this is actuality. And recently, a new condition called creatine deficiency has been found. And this is a condition that is very important because it's largely overlooked, at least in my country. And it's a pity because if you diagnose this condition, you can cure the child. So there are very few conditions that you can diagnose and cure. And creatine deficiency is one of them. It's a condition that is responsible for mental retardation and autistic features. If you don't run the investigation, the proper metabolic workup or brain MRI, you will overlook the condition. This is an MR spectroscopy. On the right-hand side, you see three peaks. On the left-hand side, you see two peaks. The child is lacking one peak. He has no creatine. If you diagnose this condition, you know that the child is creatine deficient, and if you put this child on a high creatine diet, you will cure the condition. And believe me, it's not easy to put an autistic child or a mentally retarded child in the brain MRI because it's extremely stressing. It's very, it's a source of anxiety. So you have to make enormous effort to convince the family that the child has to undergo brain MRI under general anesthesia, at least to diagnose and sometimes to find a condition that could be treatable. And I have the privilege to come across several cases of autistic / mentally retarded children that were simply creatine deficient. And after being given creatine orally, their condition has markedly improved. Dystonia, mental retardation, autistic features. I'm not claiming that all autistic children or mentally retarded children are creatine deficient. I'm saying that our challenge for we pediatric geneticists is not to cure them all, but to identify among all those children the one or the ones that can be cured. This is also a message from the history of science that a lot of advances has been made by our mentors from the previous generation. Many genetic diseases have been cured not by gene therapy, but by the surgeon and the doctors who first did organ transplantation for kidney, liver, heart, bone marrow, etc. But again and again, this is not a matter of the past only. The beauty of this is that each generation, le dor va dor, we bring new tools to the toolbox of treatment for rare genetic conditions. And you don't have to be a genius in genetics to cure some genetic disease. This is why I want to put emphasis on brain, deep brain electrostimulation for dystonia, torsion dystonia. You know, this is a very frequent genetic disease in the Jewish people, Ashkenazi Jews, and the gene is known, mutations are known, but here, neurosurgeons ignore the disease gene or the disease mechanism. They know nothing about genetics. There are zero in genetics. They don't know what an intron is or what an exon is, but they have done together much more than the whole community. This is a child who has a torsion dystonia. She is losing progressively the ability to walk. You guys know in this country this condition. It's this extremely painful condition because the child is normally intelligent and she loses the ability to walk. and the deep brain stimulation will cure not the cause, but the consequence of the condition, as you see in this child that is just awakening from the surgery, and she's awakening, and you will see her a couple of days later, the same child, a couple of days later. Believe me, this neurosurgeon is zero in genetics. He knows nothing about our field. But the beauty of this message is that we should not put all our eggs into the same basket, as the lady said. Exactly that. Even a neurosurgeon, a stupid surgeon, can cure your children. And this is a very interesting message for me. Protein and drug engineering, thanks to the companies. You have spoken, Miguel, about companies. It's very important to have companies on board, really. Because that's not our contribution, we academics, to have performed all those major achievements like hemophilia, diabetes mellitus, gross failure deficiency, etc. Those have been done by the companies that invested a lot of money to generate, to engineer those proteins to be delivered to the patient. And of course, enzyme therapy. With one caveat, of course, that is the price of those treatment. And it's an enormous effort for a country to foot the bill. It's enormous, 250, 300,000 for all those conditions. And I know that in Israel, you treat all the children, Jews and Arabs. And everywhere I go worldwide, I say that this country is the only country in the world that cure a child, whoever he is, whoever she is. And congratulations for that, because believe me, in my country, it's not so easy to cure a child. He has no role to be treated for some reason. Now, I would like to put emphasis on what is probably the scoop of the day today, that is pharmacology, after all. Once you have understood the disease mechanism and the consequence of the mutation, you can, to some extent, address the problem. You can rectify a protein folding, you can re-express gene in sickle cell anemia, you can lock a pathway, I have an example of that today, or activate a pathway, or inhibit a function, or replace a function. Once you have understood, based on the disease gene identification, once you have understood the disease mechanism of a rare, orphan disease, then you can fight. Because you understand. If you don't understand, you're like a schlemiel facing a condition, because you don't understand. You first have to understand. If you have an enzyme deficiency now, you understand. If you don't have any protein deficiency, you have to find the disease gene. But not necessarily to change the gene, but to understand the pathway that you will eventually tackle. And there are so many examples, but I have no time really. I want to catch up. We are already late. Probably one of the most spectacular examples for me, being a pediatric geneticist, is the example of tyrosine type 1. It's an awful condition, giving liver failure, kidney failure, autosomal recessive disease, very frequent in Canada, in the Maghreb as well, and the patient would die with liver failure and carcinoma and kidney failure. An enormous effort has been put in gene replacement therapy in my country. Huge amount of money. And eventually, a very smart Swedish guy found the treatment. It was not the gene therapy, believe me. He knew very little about the condition, but he knew biochemistry. He was a good biochemist. He knew biochemistry. He learned biochemistry, and he understood. And he understood that in this particular condition, where fumarate acetoacetate is deficient, this compound, succinyl acetone, is accumulating. It's an awful, extremely toxic condition. It's a very strong oncogenic drug. Gives cancer, liver cancer, etc. And he say to the guys, hey, you, this is your problem, but you know, maybe you could prevent succinyl acetone from accumulating. And the specialist of the disease say, well, how? How could you prevent succinyl acetone from accumulating? It is very easy. How? You simply have to lock the pathway upstream with a drug that is available. And you will change a very severe and fatal tyrosine type 1 into a far less severe and benign condition called tarisma type 2. And 90% of the children are cured. So you have to understand what happens. Once you have understood, then you can fight and eventually overcome. So this is my, this is the end of my first part. And I think it's a very important message from my standpoint. Until recently, the advances owe very little to gene identification and gene therapy, very little. Most of advances owe to biochemical elucidation of disease mechanism, not by our generation, but by the previous generation. NTBC is an example, Vaptan is another example, and sometimes, you know, discoveries are fortuitous. Thanks to very careful non-scientists, yet talented GPs, some conditions have been cured. And you know, of course, in Israel, you know the history of colchicine in Mediterranean fever. And you know how it happened, because it's very interesting to bear it in mind. One day, a patient with gout and FMF came to the doctor. And he said, "Doctor, I have a pain to my toe. It's swelling, it's painful." And the doctor said, "Well, you have gout. High uric acid, and I should put you on colchicine." And the patient was put on colchicine by the GP, and he came back to the GP after a couple of weeks and said, "Doctor, you are a great doctor." "Why?" he said. "Because your compound, colchicine, not only cured my gout, but it has markedly improved my FMF. No fever, no pain, no disability." And by accident, by chance, and up till now, we don't know how colchicine improves FMF. We should remember this. Serendipity can be good news sometimes. That is very important too. And this is not very surprising if we think in depth, because one does not suffer from the mutation. A mutation is not painful. I am not suffering from my mutation. I am suffering from the consequences of the mutation and the impact of the mutation on my body. And addressing not the cause, but the consequence, I think, is fair enough. Now, I'd like to move to my second part briefly, 10 to 15 minutes. And this is an introduction to the talk of Orly, who is really not only a friend, but also an example of what should be done, really. And that is the introduction of NGS and exome sequencing in our approach to diagnose condition. What I would like to show you from our institution, the Imagine Institute in Necker, is that again and again, and this is my taking home message, gene identification puts us on the right track. It points the target, the pathway. It can inspire very elegant cures. And indeed, the gene is the cause, but gene replacement is not the unique riposte. In other words, gene therapy is an option, but this is not the panacea, and this is certainly not the unique option. This is our institute, built by Jean Nouvel, Central Paris. I invite you to visit if you have time. And this is from the inside of the clinic. The beauty of this institute is that we see 30,000 patient a year in 30 reference centers for rare genetic disease. And believe me, each child is different with different genes and different mutation in the genes. So what we tackle today is exactly the problem. How can we satisfy so many different needs? And why I'm so proud of this institute is that because we have been able to bring together not only the doctors, the patients, the family support group, the families, but also the scientists. On the first floor are the patient, on the upper floors are the research team working on the same condition. So we have been able to bring together all the reagent of the reaction, in a sense. And briefly, because I know that Orly is going to talk to you about that, we first of all have to identify the condition. And there are so many. We have 30,000 genes, There are probably 9 to 10,000 genes, so it's a lot. We first of all have to diagnose them. And we, in this institute, we don't do NGS exome sequencing for all the patients. We are supported by the healthcare system, the Coupe Trolim from France, and they would pay for high-throughput resequencing of known disease genes. This they would pay. My child is mentally retarded. You would be reimbursed for the screening of the known genes. My child has muscle weakness. You will be reimbursed for the known disease gene. My child is an autistic child. My child is dwarf. My child is deaf, is blind, whatever. So we have panels of resequencing arrays by clinical entries, if you want. And once this is done, if it's diagnosed, fair enough. If it is not diagnosed, then it goes for exome sequencing in the upper floors of the research teams. So in other words, in our country, and I know that this is different from this country, the healthcare system, the Coupe Trolim, would pay for the sequencing of the known disease gene. They don't want to pay for research, but we have convinced them to charge for the screening of the known disease gene. Having said that, I want to say a word on gene therapy, because it has been a dream, and this lady is a beauty. So her name is Marina Cavazzana. She did the first gene replacement therapy for SCID, thalassemia and hemoglobinopathies. The principle of gene therapy is very elegant, especially for bone marrow disease, like SCID, severe combined immune deficiency, or hemoglobinopathies. Here, you would take the bone marrow of the patient. Once you have taken the bone marrow, you would select the CD34 plus cells, and then you go to the laboratory, you would transfect the growing cell with the recombinant DNA, and once you have this done, you would condition the patient to maximize myeloid ablation without immunosuppression to make space for the new corrected bone marrow stem cells, corrected. So you have to empty the bone marrow, to open, to make space for the corrected bone marrow. Why am I so skeptical? It's a very elegant approach. It's limited to a small number of conditions, like immune deficiency, blood marrow problems. I think it will be difficult for spinal muscular atrophy, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, or Friedreich ataxia, central nervous system, genetic disease, will be very difficult. And not only that, but the model, the paradigm of gene therapy eventually appear to be extremely difficult and risky. Why? Because at the beginning, you know, it's a honeymoon. It's great. Everything is easy. You don't have to do immunosuppression. There is no rejection of the graft and no GVHD. And you don't have to have a donor because the patient is his own donor. It's an autologous. But the risks are delayed. And my colleagues lost a couple of patients 10 years ago, leukemia. And they thought that they were quiet. And last week, 15 years later, listen, 15 years later, came a second wave of severe oncogenic problem, like lymphoma. After 15 years, we have had the first wave of complication, and now the second wave of complication is starting. So gene replacement therapy, even for bone marrow disease, is superb, but it's extremely difficult. And this is why I'm convinced the best way is what we are going to discuss today, is drug discovery, because this is basic, classical pharmacology, and this we know of. I have no time to go through all those examples from our institute. I have absolutely no time. Because I want to end in 5 minutes. But this is a long list of trials, clinical trials, that are launched in my center for genes that have been found in the Imagine Institute. And once They have been found. We have launched a clinical trial because we have in-house the patients, the doctors, the clinical research center, the family support groups, and all the facilities to launch the clinical trials. Dwarfism, achondroplasia. We have found a disease gene 20 years ago. It's a constitutive activation of the FGFR3 gene. It's a de novo mutation. And the tyrosine kinase receptor is activated constitutively. A long way to go to understand the disease mechanism. But once you have understood the disease mechanism, then you can tackle smartly how to counteract the condition. And this lady, Laurence Mallet, has been able to develop a number of approaches. And one of those approaches consists in a blockade of the downstream pathway with a C-type natriuretic peptide. And she has shown the efficacy of this compound on her mouse model of achondroplasia that get larger. The dwarf become almost normal in height and size. And now we have launched in our institute with a Biomarine, a phase 1-2, and then a phase 3 trial with this peptide that block the signaling of FGFR3 downstream. But to devise this clinical approach, you have to have understood properly the disease mechanism. If you don't understand what happens, you cannot fight. Once you have understood how the disease signals, then you can start fighting and counteracting the condition. This I wanted to skip. We have recruited, we in our institute, we launch yearly calls, and we have been able to recruit Yannick Rao. He's a very talented geneticist from Manchester, and we have recruited this guy. Superb guy, extremely charming and talented. And this guy has solved the genetic complexity of Aicardi-Goutier syndrome, which is a condition giving early onset encephalopathy and calcification with very high CNCF interferon. There are several disease genes. But whatever the disease gene, this results in the same consequences, that is a germ and virus-free chronic inflammation. Because of these enzyme deficiencies, the endogenous RNA are not properly degraded. They accumulate. And he decided to join us. Why? Not only because Aicardi and Goutier were working in our institution in the old days, but this center is a pioneer center for the treatment of AIDS. So we'll ask, why? Why AIDS and Aicardi-Goutier? What's the relationship? Why is he interested to join you as you are a center for AIDS in children? The beauty of the story is that this guy, to get rid of these accumulating RNAs, launched a trial with the drug that are given to the AIDS children, the tritherapy. Because it's the same. You want to inhibit the replication and accumulation of endogenous RNAs. Here, it's not viral. It's an endogenous RNA that trigger infection and high CSF in interferon. And the beauty is that the first trial is ongoing. It's an open trial. And we already know that is up and running. It is properly working. There are some symptoms that are markedly improved simply by using the treatment, not of a genetic condition, the treatment of AIDS. Like, again, it's a blessing. It's so interesting to cross cultures, you know. We should not stay alone. We have to work together. Kol Yisrael Areu Zeh Bazeh. This is very important. We cannot stay alone facing all those different problems. We have to sit together and work together between Israel, France, UK, America. Frida Kataxia, because Yoav Kabanchik is a mentor of this trial. Thank you, Yoav. This is a condition that we have tackled with him, having shown the disease gene and the disease mechanism. We have launched the first clinical trials. This is a condition that is also frequent in Israel. The childhood lost the ability to walk. He or she developed cardiomyopathy and diabetes. It's an autosomal recessive condition. And the gene has been found by Jean Mandel and Chamberlain. But what we have done is to identify the disease mechanism. What happened is that in that condition, the missing protein, frataxin, is responsible not only from a defective assembly of iron sulfur centers, but it also results in brain iron accumulation, accumulation of iron in brain and in many other tissues. And because of iron accumulating in those tissues, it, in the mitochondria, it reacts with oxygen and is extremely harmful. Give a phantom chemistry, gives a free radical injury to the to many centers of the mitochondria. So I came one day to Yoav in Jerusalem. I sit in his office and I ask him, Yoav, what can we do? I would like to remove iron, some iron, from the brain of my children. I know that I am not able to change the gene properly at the time. But if simply I could remove some iron to some extent, probably it would extinguish the fire to some extent. And you say, yes, there is one drug, not two, there is one single drug that can get into the brain, cross the BBB, take iron, remove iron, and eliminate iron in the urine. And based on this meeting at at University of Jerusalem, we have launched the first trial for iron removing in Friedreich ataxia. And there are many other tricks, of course, but removing iron has been extremely productive. So I would like to introduce you to another scientist, Jean-Laurent Casanova. He's an immunologist. Basically, he's not a geneticist, but he became a geneticist because, for some reason, he discovered that tuberculosis can be a genetic disease, believe me or not. And this guy has found a number of genes that are responsible for genetic predisposition to tuberculosis. He has done in privileged series of patients. And what he has done is that he has found that interferon and interferon receptor, the crosstalk between those receptors, are not properly working in some patients with genetic form and genetic susceptibility to tuberculosis. And this guy, believe me or not, I am approaching the end of my talk. Believe me or not, this guy was brave enough not to give antibiotic to the children, but simply the missing compound that is interferon. And having given interferon to the children, they get cured, not by giving antibiotic, but simply by replacing the proper system that could help the child to fight and overcome the condition. This is my last example, and then I will conclude in 2 minutes. Osteogenesis imperfecta, rare condition. The children break their bones. Even when the mother delivers, she can break the bone of the child simply by the contraction of the uterus. So the children would make hundreds of fractures, bone fractures, extremely painful, disabling, etc. And this is a very beautiful work from a colleague in Canada. His name is Francis Glorieux. And Francis decided that the gene was too big. One cannot change such a big gene, 100,000 nucleotides. But he said to himself, if we simply change the balance between synthesis and degradation of the bone, if we inhibit the osteoclastic activity, we shall promote osteoblastic activity. And simply by changing the balance between the osteoclastic and the osteoblastic activity, thanks to the biphosphonate, he has markedly improved the condition of these children. Again, having understood properly the disease mechanism. And here you see the picture of one patient before and after having been given biphosphonate. On the left-hand side, you see the green line. It's a very thin periost, breakable, thin. And after having given this compound, then you have a very thick and strong periost if you were pouring concrete in the bone. So the gene is still there, you don't care. The gene is mutated, it's still mutated, you don't care, you ignore this, but you address not the mutation, but the consequences of the mutation, and the children does much better. I would like to conclude. 2 slides. Many questions that have been addressed in the introductory remarks And thank you for those introductory remarks, because they are extremely sensible. For doctors, as we are, facing such a huge number of unique cases, are clinical trials on very small or even single cases feasible? Once you have only one patient per gene, is it conceivable? How should we launch clinical trial for one single child? Who will fund this? Who will support that? How can we proceed from extremely rare condition to more frequent condition? And again, the work on osteogenesis imperfecta turned out to be very interesting for fighting osteoporosis, very frequent bone fragility. So is it conceivable that based on those very rare condition, we should capitalize on those rare condition and some, to some extent proceed from rare to much more frequent condition? The reverse of what we have seen with AIDS and Écart-de-Gouttière, where we move from very frequent condition to a rare condition. Is the reciprocal possible? Economically, what country can foot the bill? Will the option remain economically sustainable, ethically acceptable? Fair enough to find good ideas, to find this gene, but shall we be able to fund those trials? Who will fund them? How can we join efforts worldwide between friends to fight those conditions here and there? And in this context, how shall we preserve our basic values of frugality and solidarity? Now, I'm going to my last slide. Again and again and again, understanding the disease mechanism is the key problem. Causality is what it is all about. Once we have understood that the disease mechanism, you can find, you can circumvent the problem, you can overcome the problem. If you don't understand, you are like stupid. The challenge for a pediatric geneticist as I am is not the Promethean dream to cure all those genes and all those diseases, but rather to identify among all those children the one or the ones that can be treated. Also, my third point is one should beware of single thought, dogmatism, and certainties. In Western Europe, in France in particular, it was a dogma that because the gene was the cause of the genetic disease, then gene replacement should be the treatment. It was a dogma, it was a Torah. Because it's the cause, you have to change gene. It's bullshit. You see, it didn't work. It will never work. You have to understand to overcome. So science is pragmatism, not dogmatism. And my country is a dogmatic country, you know. So it's very dangerous to be dogmatic. One has to be pragmatic. One cannot order a discovery. You can order a dress, a pen, a car. You cannot order a discovery. You cannot bet that an approach will be the good one, the only good one. We have to learn from all those mistakes, particularly with gene therapy. Keep our eyes open. And as you say, madam, certainly not put all our eggs into the same basket. Toda rabba la azmana, batzlacha.